Afternoon and good morning, everybody. Welcome to the fourth and the last day of the 2020 KU-UCI Joint Symposium. I am Youngmi Lee in the Department of Medical Education, KU. Today, we will focus the novel aspect of medical education that COVID-19 has brought to us. After listening to three lectures, we'll have an open discussion time. I ask for your active participation there, and please feel free to leave any comments or questions you might have during the presentation. Let me introduce our speakers today. First, we will have Professor Julium, and she is Assistant Dean of Education and Compliance Quality, also Director of Education Technology, and Adjunct Assistant Professor of Emergency Medicine at UCI School of Medicine. Dr. Yoon majored in computer science at Johns Hopkins University and completed her PhD in Cognitive Studies and Education at Columbia University in 2010. Today, she will give us a talk regarding medical education in the time of COVID-19. And then I will talk about the medical education adaptations in Korea University and Korea. And then the third presenter is Dr. Hyunmi Park, who is a research professor in Department of Medical Education, my department. Dr. Park, a graduate from the University of Birmingham Medical School, and she got PhD in medical education at the University of Nottingham in 2017. And she is currently working with me, and after her finishing fellowship in robotic surgery in KU Hospital. During our presentation today, we were able to learn about the virtual clinical case education which is developed in Korea University. So now we will have Professor Julie Yoon. Personally, I am very happy to finally I meet her because we are communicated several times email to meet each other, but we didn't make it. But finally, we reached to meet. So, Dr. Julium, are you ready to? Yeah, it's already videotaped. Okay. Yeah, let's move to Julium's talk.
My name is Julie Yum, and in my role here at the UCI School of Medicine as the Assistant Dean of Education Compliance and Quality and the Director of Educational Technology, I've had the firsthand opportunity to experience the impact of COVID-19 on medical education, and I'm excited to share and discuss some of these firsthand experiences with you. The objectives for this presentation are to describe COVID-19 response to restore, evolve, and transform medical education. So in a video statement sharing the August 2020 UN policy brief entitled Education During COVID-19 and Beyond, Antonio Guterres, the Secretary General of the United Nations, stated, "The future of education is here." He also went on to say that we have a generational opportunity to reimagine education. So what does this opportunity look like and where should we focus, especially in medical education? So one place that I looked to for some clues about this was EDUCAUSE. And every year, EDUCAUSE releases their top IT issues. And this year, they did something a little bit different by looking at the top IT issues emerging from the pandemic. And they looked at these top issues within three scenarios of restore, evolve, and transform. And this is the list that they have shared this year. So I wanted to use this structure to think about some of the things that have been going on in medical education in particular. So how will higher education emerge from the pandemic? The three scenarios that EDUCAUSE has identified are to restore, figuring out what to do to get back to this state we were in before the pandemic, to evolve, adapting to the new normal that we are in now, and then to transform, which is redefining our institution and taking an active role in creating the innovative future of higher education. So if we look at the first scenario to restore, we can think about first in terms of didactics. In this area, I think there was a little bit easier transition to getting back to restoring where we were because we used tools like video conferencing, which many institutions had available to them. This enabled synchronous learning virtually. It also enabled some small group learning through features like breakout rooms. In medical education, we were also fortunate to have already taken this step to do a lot of lecture capture and move to flipped classroom type learning. So we had pre-recorded content to rely on. And there also were many third-party providers who were focusing on medical students and providing them online resources to help prepare them in their education. And some of these online providers responded to the pandemic by offering free access to their resources during the early months of the pandemic. I wanted to take a moment to share a brief video from Indiana University about a study they did on the impact of COVID-19 on higher education.
I remember March 10th, 2020, like it was yesterday. I was sitting in a meeting, and it was during this meeting that we came to discover that, classes had all been transitioned to remote instruction for the spring semester. We were struck by how ill-prepared we were to answer questions about what would work well, or what students would enjoy, or what instructors would need. Teachers found themselves preparing instructional materials in complete isolation from each other. So one of the challenges that instructors had was that they were inventing the wheels each independently. So usually, again, without the company of their instructional colleagues that might make a teaching community a little bit more fulfilling. The change that I think would be most beneficial, especially one that I think is going to reflect highly on places like Indiana University and on teachers who care, and on students who are especially interested in being engaged in their learning process, is the importance of community. And that will make for a better learning experience, but also for better learning outcomes, because there's a spectacularly strong relationship to the quality of somebody's experience in a course and what they get out of that course. And now we're discovering that collaboration is actually an important element in that. This is one spectacularly impactful event that's happened in all of our lives. Without question, this will change the way that higher education is conducted from here on out.
So at UC Irvine, we surveyed our first-year students about their experience transitioning from in-person to remote learning from the March through the June time period, and asked them a series of questions about their experience. 88% of the students told us that they felt comfortable using the online platforms for their learning, which wasn't necessarily surprising because they were using the same tools that they had been using earlier throughout the year. So the same learning management system, the video conferencing tool, the online resources. However, as with the Indiana University study, only 38% of the students found it easy to interact with faculty during the remote instruction, and only 29% felt it was easy to interact with fellow students while using an online platform. And I think this is one place in which restoring our pre-pandemic levels of community and collaboration have been challenging and are something that we need to strive for, different ways in which we can find an ability to restore the sense of community. So assessments are another area in which there was a lot of focus on restoring the pre-pandemic levels too. We were fortunate that the USMLE and the NBME, the bodies that administer the national board exams and subject exams, made the move during early on in the pandemic to offer us alternate ways in which to administer the exams. So previously, the NBME subject exams were only available in person with proctoring and very strict rules about how this proctoring would happen. And the USMLE exams were only administered through the Prometric centers in the US. So the NBME enabled remote web-based administration, and we were able to shift in about the April timeframe, being able to administer these exams, especially for our clinical year students, so that they could stay on schedule with their clerkships. And the USMLE offered event-based opportunities for institutions like UCI to offer these step one, step two CK, CS exams locally at the schools. So this picture is actually taken from an event-based USMLE step one exam administration. This really helped our students stay on track to complete the exam during their third year. Though we had moved the deadline, it enabled for those who had been studying to have an opportunity to take the exam at the school in an environment where they're comfortable and not have to worry about if their Prometric Center was going to close on their scheduled exam dates. We also were able to continue administering our local high stakes exams. We have an online exam administration tool called ExamSoft. We had been administering exams on the iPad through ExamSoft for several years, and we were able to transition to doing that for students remotely. Our OSCEs, or our clinical exams, were able to continue in person, but with physical distancing measures put in place and some adjustments to the way the cases were delivered. And then our anatomy practicals were also able to be given in person with small core cohorts who were in a pod. Now, with assessments, there were issues that did come up due to the remote administration in response to the pandemic. Remote proctoring was an issue that was really at the forefront of assessments. There are really three types of remote proctoring. So live online means that a proctor can watch a student remotely through a tool like video conferencing and actually proctor the exam as it's going. There's also the ability to record a student taking an exam and then look at it later for testing irregularities. Or there are now automated systems that allow the use of artificial intelligence programs to determine if there were testing irregularities that happened. There are also issues about question security. So now that the exams are being administered remotely, faculty who have spent time and effort creating question banks were more concerned about the ability for their questions to get out there into the public. And so we did things like look at the item analysis through the online exam administration tool and see if there were any differences that stood out to us for those questions and exams that were administered remotely versus in person. And we have not really seen any significant differences yet. We've also taken an effort to tag all the questions in our online exam administration tool so that we know which ones were administered remotely, so that in subsequent years, a faculty member can think twice about offering the question or maybe alter the question a little bit if they feel that question security was an issue. Technical support is a huge area that impacts the remote administration of exams. First and foremost, you need to have an online exam administration tool to be able to offer them remotely. You also need to be concerned about network bandwidth at the students' remote locations and their access to devices to be able to take the exams remotely. The picture that you see here is one of our solutions, which is to offer in-person exam administration in a physically distant way so that those who did have challenges technically could come in and take the exam. There's also the issue of comparability. For exams that were traditionally administered in person and now administered remotely, there's the question of whether the performance on the exams and all the conditions and things that revolve around the remote administration impact the students as they take them in these alternate formats. And there's also the question of the national benchmark. So, you know, people across the United States were impacted by COVID-19 at different levels, meaning some may have had to move to remote administration sooner than others or not at all. And the impact that the standardized exams could have on student performance. So the NBME did some preliminary analysis on the data that came out during the earlier months of the pandemic. And so far, they haven't been able to find any significant differences in student performance. I think what we will have to do is see as the COVID-19 pandemic continues and as we are stay in this state that we're in, how the performance is impacted due to a variety of reasons. So now let's look at how higher education has emerged from the pandemic in the evolved scenario. Guidance from the AAMC and the LCME early on made it clear that medical students were part of the essential emerging physician workforce and that they must have continued patient care experiences where it was possible to do safely during the COVID-19 pandemic. So before, I just want to take a moment to pause and share an aside. So at UCI, the anteater is our UCI school mascot. And the sound that the anteater makes, the rallying cry, is the zot, zot, zot. And so this is a picture of President Barack Obama, who spoke at our commencement in 2014, which was the 50th anniversary of UCI, doing the zot, zot, zot. And I share this with you because as part of UCI's effort to evolve medical education, we came up with this Zotbot. Dr. Heather Hoffman and Dr. Cameron Harding, who were the co-clerkship directors for our internal medicine clerkship, really recognized that there was a missed opportunity for our medical students in not being able to see COVID-19 patients and seeing the pandemic and learning about how to treat patients with this new disease firsthand. There was also a decrease in the number of direct patient care opportunities because they were not able to go into rooms with COVID-19 patients. And so one answer to this was to bring that experience to the student, and hence the birth of the Zotbot. So in the first version, the Zotbot was an iPad that was attached to the computer on wheels that the attending rolls around as they round on their patients. In this first iteration, it was attached to the computer on wheels with an elastic band. And the iPad was used to Zoom with the students. So the students were remote and the attending would be with the patient. And the Zoom session would then capture the patient encounter that occurred with the attending and the COVID-19 patient. And the students were able to interact with the patients and learn from them and then listen in on how the care and the treatment of these patients was undergoing. In the second version of the Zotbot, Dr. Harding and Dr. Hoffman used removable glue strips to be able to attach it to the computer on wheels and roll it around. And then in the current version, Zotbot version 3, we were able to get a rolling cart for the iPad. So we had initially ordered this rolling cart, but due to the supply chain demands, it was really hard to get a rolling cart. So it took about 2 months from the time we ordered it for it to actually arrive. But once it arrived, we had an easier way for attendings to take the iPad on rounds. And then We also were able to attach a portable Shure mic via a lightning connector to the iPad, and that enabled us to get greater multi-directional sound, because as students were telling us, depending on how the iPad was positioned in the earlier versions, it was harder to hear either the patient or the attending at times, or anyone in the care team. And by the summer, we had had over 100 students across all 4 years that had been able to experience a COVID-19 round with the ZopBot. And this was significant in that, you know, typically on the internal medicine clerkship, we'll have about 15 to 20 students that may round, and on a particular team, maybe even a smaller number of students than that. But what the ZopBot allowed was as many students as could join in that Zoom session to actually experience this these patient encounters, and enabled students beyond just those enrolled in the clerkship. So now we had first and second year students who never really get this direct opportunity to round with students on a clerkship. This also enabled students who were quarantining, but feeling well enough to actually join and continue in direct patient care encounters. It just overall was a very positive and welcome addition to the internal medicine clerkship. I have up here a quote from one of the third year students after experiencing a ZopBot COVID-19 round. And the student said, "The entire experience was so cool, probably the coolest thing I've seen in MS3, given the context we are now learning within. In particular, hearing the 30-year-old patient who lost his brother to COVID on March 30th talk to us after being on a vent and giving us really sweet advice and encouragement. He is a gem of a person. He made me and many of my classmates cry from how heartening his candid nature was in the midst of such suffering." This quote really highlighted how our students, the patients, and the attendings were able to benefit by evolving the experience a little bit, opening their minds and enabling this opportunity through the ZopBot. Another experience that helped us to evolve is the creation of the pandemic preparedness elective. So in a very short period of time, we were able to put together an elective that taught COVID-19 related clinical knowledge. It was evident that this was an opportunity, again, to teach about something that was happening in the moment, and that we didn't want to wait until time had passed to give students the opportunity for this learning experience. The elective was structured as a two-week elective. It was open to students from any of the years in medical school. It was structured in a hybrid model. So a hybrid model, which is often used in higher education or in traditional didactic setting or in our basic science courses, wasn't always thought of as a priority in our clinical courses. So this elective used online video conferencing and active discussion board involvement. It also included in-person simulation and standardized patient training opportunities. And again, what we've learned is that moving forward, as we're designing our clerkships or rethinking our clinical courses, that we should consider a hybrid model from the start, so that when we encounter a new situation where we need to adapt quickly, we'll have already taken the steps to be able to respond to it. And another way in which medical education can evolve is to think about how we're using our learning spaces. So moving to remote means that many of the classrooms and the lecture halls and the small group learning spaces that we had set up are not being used to their full capacity at the moment. Thinking about how we can repurpose these or redesign spaces as we move forward and thinking about hybrid teaching and online teaching. I wanted to share an example from Johns Hopkins University about one way in which they have been thinking about doing this.
We're all looking forward to coming back, but what will that look like? I'm Sri Sarma, an associate professor in biomedical engineering at the Whiting School of Engineering. And like many of you, my spring and summer has looked a lot like this. So I am really looking forward to coming back to campus this fall, even though I know it will be different. And the university is building on-campus studios to improve the experience. I've always felt tied down and tired delivering lectures from home, so it was a great feeling to be able to finally get up and walk around while I deliver my lectures.
I always found that it's much more difficult when you're sitting at home to give a good talk, and this has like a sense of immediacy that I really liked. I didn't feel that that's a virtual audience. I felt the same enthusiasm about giving the lecture, the same enthusiasm about engaging the audience.
So now let's move on to the third scenario of emerging from the pandemic, and that is to transform. If you recall, the EDUCAUSE list for transform included these five items, and number one in this list was institutional culture. When thinking about institutional culture, I found this from McKinsey & Company, which is a global survey they did of executives of Fortune 500 and large companies. And what they found was that responses to COVID-19 has speeded the adoption of digital technologies by several years, and that many of these changes could be here for the long haul. I suspect that if there was a similar survey done of medical education leadership, that we would see similar results. So what McKinsey found in their survey was that companies who thought that it took years to implement a new technology solution were able to do it in a matter of weeks and sometimes days, and that technology, which was thought of as an ability to automate or to make processes more efficient, was actually critical in being able to redefine how they maintain their competitive advantage. And I think in medical education, technology is also going to be seen as being able to provide the educational advantage for their students. AR and VR, augmented reality and virtual reality, was something that medical schools had been discussing in the recent years prior to the pandemic. And use cases for this in medical education included anatomy and physiology, communication empathy skills, patient simulations. And there was a very excited view about integrating these types of technologies into our schools. And yet it wasn't happening at the pace that one would expect given the excitement that was going on around it. But during COVID-19, things were happening, as you know, at a pace where we didn't have a choice but to keep up and make sure that we could maintain the level of education in our medical schools. Doctors Glenn Posner, Jerry Maniate, and Janet Perel, who is a colleague and friend of mine, came together through Twitter and realized that there was a need for having content for healthcare providers about how to treat COVID-19 patients. They created a series of 17 cases using 360 video. They were able to do this in a matter of months versus years, and this content is up and readily available for broad consumption, and is a really great example of how technology adoption during COVID-19 was accelerated due to an unprecedented need. Virtual reality used in distance learning was also something explored by Embodied Lab. And Embodied Labs is a company that UC Irvine has been using to deliver virtual reality cases around communication skills and empathy building for our medical students. We admittedly didn't have the time to implement the distance learning, but the folks at the Cal State University Channel Island School of Nursing were able to do this. And the way that it works is that the instructors will wear the virtual reality headset and narrate and reflect as they're going through the experience. And this experience can then be projected out to the students remotely so that they're able to get the perspective
from an expert and keep up learning that might not otherwise be possible. And finally, another way in which medical education can really be transformed and has become more apparent through the COVID-19 pandemic is the idea of removing timelines around learning. Competence-based education is something that has been talked about a lot in higher education and in medical education. And it's this idea of students going through a medical education program and meeting competencies at their own timeframes rather than the fixed, for example, 4-year timeframe or 3-year timeframe that medical schools have traditionally structured their programs around. There's also this idea of the master adaptive learner. There's a textbook now out by a group of great medical educators in the AMA Accelerating Change in Medical Education Consortium. And the idea of the master adaptive learner combines the concept of self-regulated learning and continuous quality improvement. So I wanted to close with this quote that actually a classmate of mine, Dr. Martin Pusick, who's now at the Harvard Medical School, shared in his work with the AMA. And he says, "We have no idea what medical systems will look like 10 years from now when today's students will enter the workforce, let alone when they've been in practice 20 years. By training them to be master adaptive learners, we are giving them the tools to adapt." And I think it's thinking in this way and looking at the things we have done over the past few months and seeing how we can transform what we have been doing to go beyond just an emergency response and considering it as a part of the start for the future of medical education. And then I wanted to close by saying, Kamsahamnida, thank you. If you would like to reach me, this is my email address. Thank you again for giving me this opportunity to share and present with you today.
Thank you so much, Julie. I was very impressed with your lecture, especially chatbot and other technology invented tools. And it's moved to my talk. Once again, I introduce myself. I'm Youngmi Lee from Department of Medical Education. I graduated from Korea University College of Medicine, and I trained as a family physician. After my training, I went to USC, UN Neighbor University, and I finished my master program in medical education. And then I have been working for the Department of Medical Education for the last 20 years. So let's move to my video.
Good evening and good morning, dear colleagues. I'm very pleased and honored to have a chance to talk for this KU-UCI joint conference. I'm Youngmi Lee from Department of Medical Education, and I'm going to talk about the medical education adaptations during COVID-19 in South Korea and my university. And my colleague, Dr. Hyunmi Park, will address how we are developing a virtual clinical case education. Over the last few days during this joint conference, you already have had an extensive explanation on the COVID situation in South Korea. I would like to briefly address the situation related to medical education though. As you can see in this graph, the blue are the new COVID-19 cases. And the positive COVID patient rapidly increased, and the new daily case number hit over 900 on the 29th of February. The usual start of a Korean academic year is March 2nd, So it's a blessing in guise. The academic year have not yet started yet, as the school could be kept shut and education was moved online. On 29th of February, the government announced the social distancing rules. In Korea, we have KAMC, which is a Korean Academy of Medical Colleges, which is like of double AMs in States. On February 24th, KAMC recommended the delayment of starting new spring semester to the middle of March, and they recommend again the suspension of clerkship education on February 29th. So KU and other medical colleges had to stop the offline lectures and clinical clerkship from 29th of February. South Korea adopted a three-level social distancing schema, and cities decide the level according to the daily new number positive patient. And for last semester, most of the time we were in level 2. Fortunately, we have not experienced level 3 so far. This table shows KU guideline for academic administration level 1 to 3. For last semester and so far, we have been mostly level 2, so it means we can have offline classes and offline tests if students' number is less than 50 in a classroom. So in my university, in medical school, special medical school, we have offline test at the end of last semester, and now we also have offline test with students, less than 50 students in a classroom. In this May, KAMC asked the medical school deans about medical adaptations and challenges during COVID-19 pandemic. And for this survey, out of 40 medical schools, 37 deans participated. Like other countries, preclinical courses were changed online education, and the area of least change due to the relatively controlled COVID spread in Korea were clinical rotations and assessment area. Clinical rotation could be started again from March 16th with average 3 weeks suspension. The majority of assessment for the preclinical and clinical years were just delayed, or some of assessment were conducted on-site under strict governmental infection prevention guidelines. Pure online assessment was only tried in 4 schools for pre-med years and summer hybrid online on-site exam. The challenges faced were mainly due to technical and user inexperience issues and the lack of finance and human resources. This problem affected the preclinical phase the most. For the clinical students, their clerkship activities were sacrificed for their safety, which resulted in limited learning opportunity during their hospital clerkship. The teaching hospitals and clinicians had to put the treatment of patient above their teaching commitment. However, generally, the deans comment on changes in medical education introduced by COVID-19 were positive. We were very surprised at the overwhelming positive comments we received from the dean during these difficult times. The dean said, after the initial teasing problems, there have been increased confidence level for all stakeholders, medical students' high acceptance of adaptability to online learning, and they applied diverse online teaching and learning methods, and in so, these changes promoted students' self-directed learning. And also, online medium was useful in supporting students who needed remedial education. Thanks to adaptation taken by COVID-19, they could reinforce the education system environment for online education. And most importantly, there was an attitudinal change toward medical education itself and online medical education. Now let's move on to Korea University again. This graph shows KU overall curriculum map. So we have 6 years, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But first 2 years is pre-medicine course and 4 years medical course. The starting date of each semester are differently by study years. For pre-med course, usual starting date are same as other disciplines in the university. It means beginning of March and September. However, as you can see in the table, medicine starts 3 or 2 weeks earlier than other disciplines. And the core clerkship at the year 3 and year 4 electives are usually started in January. So we adapted our curriculum according to the COVID pandemic social distancing rule. So as I mentioned earlier, we have to stop all campus online campus class on late of February, and year for preclinical years, all classrooms are still continued online, and year three, the as I mentioned earlier, 3 weeks after 3 weeks suspension, we can sustain the hospital rotation. So most of the preclinical courses have had online, but Department of Anatomy used a blended approach during the last semester. Anatomy lecture also changed entirely online, but from the middle of May, anatomy dissection lab was held at on-campus lab. This picture shows how we prepared a student with a PPI before entering the dissection room. Actually, for the last semester, our online education was mainly large group lecture, and we could not provide a small group discussion properly. However, from the second semester, which was start in September, we have used the Zoom online conference more actively than the first semester. And this picture shows small group discussions by student group with or without faculty members. As I mentioned earlier, student assessment in Korea mostly have been operate on campus with maintaining 2 meter distance and infection prevention measures. However, last week in my university, we had finally 2 positive confirmed medical students who are supposed to take examination this coming Friday. After several discussion, we decide to provide online examination to students with the cheating prevention measures. You can see in this picture, the course director provide this guideline to the student how they can prove they are free from cheating. They have to record their appearance during the online examination, like these pictures, using their own smartphone or other computer device. However, at this point, we should deliberately consider online examination and potential teaching behavior. You may heard of open book tests in the UK. Some of medical educators in Korea also like this approach. However, this type of online examination has not yet widely accepted, especially by students. The reason why the most of medical colleges in Korea still use a grading system instead of pass and fail in student assessment. So most of the students are very sensitive and nervous of their grading and do not trust that online examination is credible. In my medical school now, seriously consider the change of student assessment system to criterion reference instead of a ROM reference grading system. And also we are trying to apply portfolio evaluation system as a step to develop a basis of programmatic assessment. From this November, as you can see in this graph, we are midst of a third wave. Daily new cases are over 300, unfortunately. But we are still under 31,000 cumulative cases. So far, disruption in medical education in South Korea are not so serious like other countries in terms of sustaining clerkship and having safe offline examination. However, we never know what will happen tomorrow and the day after tomorrow. Korea and my university should prepare the future. So now we are preparing a virtual learning clinical case and platform. My colleague, Dr. Hyunmik Park, will address what we have been doing for developing virtual clinical learning platform. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your attention again, and let's move to third presenter, Dr. Hyunmik Park. She will talk about how we are developing virtual case and how we are preparing future. So let's move to Dr. Hyunmik Park's video.
Good afternoon in California and good morning in Korea. My name is Hyunmik Park and I am a research professor at the Department of Medical Education at Korea University and a British colorectal surgeon by trade. It is a pleasure to meet you all, albeit online, and I am grateful we are still able to share our scientific knowledge in the middle of this pandemic. I would like to share with you a couple of projects that our medical school has been undertaking within the realms of online education. First, the online international case discussions, and secondly, the development of a Korea-specific interactive virtual reality clinical case platform. From the aforementioned game, the Global Alliance of Medical Excellence team, three Asian medical schools have come together. And we have started a pilot program to discuss clinical cases led by faculty from Korea, Japan, and Hong Kong. The medical students who have joined us include the three East Asian countries, as well as German students. We meet over the Zoom platform fortnightly to discuss clinical cases brought by the faculty who lead the sessions on their own clinical specialty, which in this pilot have included pediatrics, surgery, and internal medicine. The purpose of these meetings are various, but in the current pandemic situation, international clinical exchange programs have all come to a halt, and this will give the students the chance to meet and get to know each other, as well as having the opportunity to discuss clinical cases in English, which is not the first language of any of the students involved. We have grouped the students into four or five, mixing them up according to their extracurricular interests, such as which musical instruments they play. We envisage that there will also be opportunities to discuss different clinical presentations or differential diagnosis, depending on the disease prevalence of each country and potentially varying treatment protocols. This was 2 weeks ago when students were discussing the images of a child's chest.
I can start if no one else wants to. So we go A, B, C, D, E for a chest x-ray. So A, looking at the airways, the trachea, it kind of looks like it's a little bit deviated to the right. Mm-hmm. B, looking at the lung fields, it's kind of hazy opacities. I would almost say like ground glass opacities that Kiara said, and that's kind of confirmed in the CT on the left with like kind of like almost emphysematous, almost like honeycomb quality to it. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have cardiomegaly, so that's fine. C, D, the diaphragm. It doesn't look like there's much of like a pleural effusion because I can follow the recesses all the way down.
Exactly.
And everything else, I mean, I don't think he's going to have a problem with his bones.
Surin, are you here? Yes, I can see you. So Surin, do you know what does the ATG?
ATG, the anti-thymocyclobulin. I know that it is used with cyclosporin usually.
I can start if no one else wants to. So we go A, B, C, D, E for a chest x-ray. So A, looking at the airways, the trachea, it kind of looks like it's a little bit deviated to the right.
Mm-hmm.
B, looking at the lung fields, it's kind of hazy opacities. I would almost say like ground glass opacities that Kiara said, and that's kind of confirmed in the CT on the left with like, kind of like almost emphysematous, almost like honeycomb quality to it.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't have cardiomegaly, so that's fine. C, D, the diaphragm. It doesn't look like there's much of like a pleural effusion because I can follow the recesses all the way down.
Exactly.
And everything else, I mean, I don't think he's going to have a problem with his bones.
Surin, are you here? Yes, I can see you. So Surin, do you know what does the ATG?
ATG, the anti-thymocyclobulin. I know that it is used with cyclosporin usually.
There is a clear difference between the Western and Eastern students. The Eastern students tend to be a lot more shy, but by being regularly exposed to an array of faces and accents, and by making sure they understand this is a safe place where there is no wrong question or wrong answer, we hope that this platform will encourage them to come out of their shells. So far, the feedback has been very promising. Next, I would like to give you a glimpse of the virtual reality platform that we are developing with a software company. During this pandemic, we have relied heavily on digital content for our lectures so far, and our clinical year students have been lucky as they have been able to continue attending their hospital placements. But we know that this will not be the last epidemic that might disturb future clinical experiences like it has in Europe or medical schools in the States. Therefore, to not only prepare for such public health crisis, but also to cater to the current Generation Z students, our university has embarked in finding the most suitable virtual reality platform to be an adjunct to patient contact. There are already a few companies that provide such clinical cases, but what I have noticed when trialing a handful of them is that there is not only a language barrier, but also a significant cultural and healthcare system difference on how the patients are being portrayed. Therefore, we have decided to develop our own. Similar to already existing products, there will be patients with different presenting complaints of multiple age ranges and backgrounds. They could be presenting to the outpatient clinic or to the emergency department, and after history taking, the patient could be examined with their observations visible on screen. The relevant investigations could be requested by the student, which will then reveal the appropriate images. As we all know, the pandemic has just accelerated the inevitable future of digitalized education, and the current Generation Z have embraced it like ducks to water. Therefore, educators have to catch up and keep up and develop for the sake of our future workforce by developing programs which are interactive, tailor-made, student-centric, but importantly, it has to be valid and reliable so that it can be in the future also be used for formative and summative assessments. Thank you very much for your attention. Please keep safe, and I do hope that we will be able to conduct such conferences by meeting in person in the near future. Goodbye.
we have listened to all three lectures prepared for this morning and afternoon, and it's now time to discuss. So if you have any comments and questions, please let us know who you are and then make a question or a comment.
I wanted to start off by making a comment. It was so interesting to hear about, you know, the similarities that we had in our education and medical education response during COVID-19 pandemic, but also the differences because of the way our situation was between the two countries. And it was really enlightening to hear from your side how the Korean medical schools have approached this, and I hope that we can continue to learn from each other as we go through this process.
Thank you for your comment. And I have many questions to you about how you prepare the virtual learning case, because I've learned from that UCI is already developed some virtual clinical cases before. So do you have any experience or challenges while you are developing virtual cases?
Yeah, so primarily for in terms of virtual cases, we've been doing virtual reality using headsets. So but that's primarily been around for us communication and empathy skills, and we were fortunate to be able to have included these virtual cases into our OSCEs or our clinical exams for some of our clerkships. And we've also tried doing some pilot studies looking at the experience of going through a virtual patient case and learning about their experience from the first person perspective. So a case that Embodied Labs started with is this 76-year-old male African-American who has macular degeneration. And so when you put on the virtual reality headsets, you're seeing the world through his view with macular degeneration. And for many people, it's hard to imagine what it's like to have such a condition and then to, you know, experience it and see that, oh my gosh, a simple thing like blowing out birthday candles in front of you is not easy to do, will help you build that empathy. And then what we did was we compared that to a in-person case where they met with a geriatric patient. And our goal was to see if you went through the virtual experience first, did you have more empathy? Was your communication and your counseling with the patient better? We don't have a large enough sample size to know if there is a significant difference yet, but certainly the means are showing that if you do the virtual experience first, that there are, you know, that your counseling and your communication skills are seemingly better. We are looking to see if there's other ways, and I think this idea of the way the group did the COVID-19 cases using 360 video, if there are ways for us to use technology that's more accessible to create a larger variety of virtual clinical cases, because right now I think the challenge is having, as you had mentioned, the staff and the resources to be able to develop cases quickly and that are effective. And I think as people have more skills coming in with that, we'll be able to do that better.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for your talk. It was very interesting. I've got a question for Julie. So you were already doing your exams on a computer-based platform on site, and this was moved remotely. My question is if you had any questioning from the students on the validity of such, and if there was any that kind of question is mine, yes, because we at the moment have we will be preparing for online exams. We haven't actually done them fully just yet.
Yeah, and that's a very, I think that question actually comes both from the student perspective and the faculty perspective. So as I had mentioned, the faculty concerns are around the question security, right? So the in-person proctoring environment enables us to make sure that the questions stay secure. And that way, you know, questions aren't, you know, handed out to students, and we can hope that the validity of that exam is, you know, higher. The other, we do have, you know, students who have not been accustomed to taking exams online, and now in this situation, there are a couple issues with students taking, from the student perspective of taking the exams online. So first there's their, you know, do they feel comfortable, you know, having to deal with all the other issues around the technology? And, you know, is there stress because they're not in a testing sort of environment? And in our survey results, we've had the students explain to us in some cases that they feel this way. And then there's the other spectrum where students feel comfortable because they're able to do and take the test in their own, in the comfort of their own homes. And then there's the question about whether, you know, there's, you know, academic honesty around taking the exam. And so you mentioned setting up cheating, looking for cheating and students who are being dishonest. And certainly that's a concern for our students as well. Mm-hmm. We recently moved to proctoring. We had run the exams on honor code, and we recently moved to proctoring them, our in-house exams online. It went well. I think the students felt comfortable about it, and we'll see how their feelings about taking the exams online and the academic honesty issues around it will change because now they're being proctored.
If there is any other comment or question, please feel free to say.
Okay,
hello, my name is Su-Jin Kim. I'm emergency physician, and these days we have some clinical clerkship student, and so it is difficult to learn the clinical clerkship training in emergent, especially emergency department and the critical care area. And so, are you learning the clinical clerkship programs in emergency department or the intensive care unit? And also, difficult to teach clinical clerkship student in emergency department, because the many emergency patient we don't have any previous history or contact history, and so they are exposed to the danger or dangerous. Sometimes they are very the student in the dangerous situation, and so we are blocked. Sometimes I talk to my student to do not touch ER patient, or just they are observed the situation, and so I'm very curious about how do you learning the clinical clerkship programs in your hospital.
I don't know if that's questions for me. I also know that our Vice Dean of Medical Education, Dr. Kanvan Lee Buckland, is also on, and I didn't know if she wanted to chime in, but we have been running. We took a pause of direct clinical activities for about 2.5 weeks in the April timeframe, but since then, our clerkships have been running in person as they did previously. Certainly some didactic sessions were moved online as much as possible. And then the direct patient care activities were also impacted a little bit because students can't go see COVID patients. But for the most part, our clerkships have been functioning as they best they could, you know, to pre-pandemic levels. We've been, and I think that also is a product of, you know, our situation in Orange County. So our colleagues certainly in like in the LA area are not having the same sort of experience, but we've been able to do this, and they are in the emergency medicine clerkship as well, and they are, you know, doing their you know, ICU rotations. Dr. Lee Buckland, did you want to add anything?
Sure. So as Dr. Yeom mentioned, we did have a pause to get, especially around the time where there was a PPE shortage. Now that our resources are there, the students are back. We view our students as a part of the healthcare team. So once we had enough PPE to cover them, they pretty much are back to normal, except for they are not allowed to see patients that are being triaged for COVID. So if a patient comes in with a lot of respiratory symptoms, they're triaged in a separate area in the emergency room, and then the students are not in there. And then they also do not see patients on a, we have a specific COVID ward. So the patients that are COVID positive are in a particular part of our hospital, and the students won't see patients there.
Just a comment on how similar things are across the world is that the current generation of students are so comfortable with the online platform that they just, in Korea as well, when we surveyed them after a few months, they thought that it would be better just to continue with the online lecturing even after the pandemic. And one of the comments that I heard from Julie was that the removing the timeline, and that was one of the things that they were able to connect and learn at their own pace and repeat if necessary. So it was actually catering for the individual needs of the student, and that was quite a positive thing. Then I was quite happy to see the computer on wheels as well. I used to have them in the UK just for our own practice, and we used to call them cows, because that's what it is computer on wheels. It's a cow used to follow us. The difference here, I think, for our COVID patients, the level of protection that the healthcare staff wear in Korea when they are dealing with patients is level D. They look like spacesuits, and they can hardly barely hear each other, let alone be able to actually teach in that environment. We have had the protections that we've been taking for our students and our staff has been quite a high level, and that's why we have had a very low level of transmission between the healthcare staff, and also as a country we've had very low levels of death rates, and I think that unfortunately translates to a lower threshold in protecting our students, and that might have an impact on our students' clinical education. But obviously we are hoping that different types of virtual reality or technologies will be able to at least take part of that education onto an online platform. Thank you.
Okay, I have one question for maybe Professor Ebert. UCI also manages the PhD course, right? So,
Yes.
So, the education, class, you opened the class in this time, right? So how to manage the class in UCI?
In terms of PhD courses, the graduate school courses have been running online. Individual lecturers came up very often with their own materials, and then people such as Assistant Dean Yum would work with them to make sure that they could use those online with the students. And then in terms of actual in-lab teaching, which is obviously very important for graduate students, mm-hmm. and for undergraduate students in our Bio 199 program, we've had to ramp down to 30% occupancy of labs at any one time. So that means that we have shift systems going so that people sign into calendaring systems in the labs so that they can spread out people over the course of a day. We have research ramp-up plans that were implemented when we went from phase one, which is the most restrictive, essential personnel only, to phase two, so that people had to submit a ramp-up plan that would be examined by the department chair and approved ultimately by the chair and by leadership to make sure that everyone can stay safe. We have visitor plans that we approve or review and approve or modify if people need to have visitors to come in and demo equipment or salesmen to show equipment, so we can keep everything running safely and not have too much of a detriment to graduate school and undergraduate education.
Okay,
so cool. It requires constant monitoring, basically.
Yeah. Here we, the lab, the laboratory always open for the graduate student, even the internship student, but class, depending on the student number, so small number we can open the face-to-face class, but big class we use the online system. And it,
is there anybody wants to make a comment or a question? Yes, please. Professor Han.
Hi. I'm Hee-Chul Han, and I'm in charge of the Korea Association of Medical Colleges. And almost for a year, we have been fighting against the COVID-19. Including me and with my 40 deans of medical colleges. And the COVID made us change the medical education into online form. So, and I thank for the Korean University to show the effort to develop a VR portal for the medical education in online. But I think the most of the colleges is changing the medical education into online form. So, but I think we have to find some way how to guarantee the competence of the online education, especially in the clinical clerkship. So I hope everybody try to find a good way to ensure the competence of the outcome. Okay, thank you.
Thank you for your very important and valuable comment.
May I have a question?
Yes, please.
Yes, I'm Hong Seung Lee, and it is very nice to meet Julie and the Kwan. We met last year at UCI. It is very difficult situation under the COVID-19 and the medical education. I think medical education should be based on a real world situation. So COVID-19 is a real situation. So my question is the certain commitment for the society. I heard the American medical student early graduate to the, serve the patient. Do you have any program to volunteering for the helping the society?
Julie, do you want to answer, or you want me to?
Oh, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, it's interesting. I think one of the most wonderful things out of the COVID situation is I can tell you at first when this all hit, our students did not want to go outside. They did not want to see patients. They were very concerned about their safety. And then, so we were actually managing their fears about coming into the hospital, going out and doing things. And then after a few weeks and months, I think they started really missing that element of the medical profession. Just really missing seeing patients, missing serving the community. And so our students actually ended up coming out in full force, really doing things on their own, actually organizing things on their own, like mass collections, like food delivery to the elderly. They actually, because our faculty were were very busy with the surge of patients. They were babysitting, walking dogs. And so I think that, you know, inherent thing that they went into medicine for, the altruistic spirit, really came out. But I could tell you at first it did not. At first, we were dealing with a lot of scared, angry students sometimes, but over time they've come to really commit themselves to the profession. And so when we actually slowly had to put them back in the clinical environment, for example, because many of them were saying that they wanted to start seeing patients again, they wanted to be back in the clinical environment. And so we are seeing them really serve the patients, but also the community in a very big way.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
I also wanted to add, I mean, one of the ways in which they really served, you know, our medical center community was, you know, we are fortunate to have a makerspace, so we have 3D printers, and we had a group of students that led, and they were very thoughtful about this. They were physically distanced in our building, so they would sign up for shifts, and they 3D printed face shields for delivery to the hospital. I think they 3D printed about 5,000 face shields, because early on it was really hard, again, with all these supply chain issues, to get PPE and supplies, and they felt that that was a way that they could contribute, and they really worked round the clock to get things ready by they had a deadline, and then they were able to deliver it to the hospital. It was really an amazing way to see them come together and do something for, our healthcare workers that they will work with, when they go back into the hospital or when they're at the hospital.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for sharing your experience in student volunteering. And I have a suggestion from Professor Go. He is very much interested in virtual reality things. So please, Professor Go-Jae-Chul is.
Thank you. I think because one of the greatest advantages of the virtual reality guided education is that we can provide experience options for the patients, because I mostly perform the intervention procedures. One of the shortcomings of this COVID-19 outbreak is that we cannot provide students or trainees to perform the procedures by themselves. So can I share my my screen, please, or the minister, please. If you don't mind, can you just allow me to share my computer screen? Because it is blocked by the Zoom. Okay, because I want to share something. Ah, yeah, thank you very much. So I just want to share that this is what I did at one of my conference, and by using the virtual reality, or I'm just already preparing for the augmented reality guided educations too. But I think one of the greatest privileges is that the trainees or students can perform the procedure and get the learning by doing the procedures by themselves. As you see, I just made this, the virtual character, because if I share my vision on the head mounted display, maybe it will be a little bit, dizzy, but if you use the head mounted display, you can share this whole world in the all this virtual world, and I think you can see the structures, and you can perform the, you can grab the needle and perform the procedure yourself like this. You can grab the needle and do the procedure on the virtual reality system. So this is my question, that is there anyone, including my institution and the University of the Irvine University, who are interested in this virtual reality guided simulation system that I made. This is my question.
Yeah, I'm very much interested in your system. So we have to incorporate your developed module to our clinical case development. So please help us.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
I've just got a question for Jeffrey Abbott, if that's possible, if we can go back to the main page where we can see it. It's about the postgraduate student competencies. If the laboratory work is the main source of work and their work has been halted because of their inability to come into the hospital or university to do their work, has that increased the time frame for the studies, or they just have to catch up later?
Yeah, that's a really good question. In fact, I was on a Zoom meeting, as we all are these days, with about that today. So the feeling is that there will be multiple impacts on graduate students. There will obviously be delays, that obviously mental health impacts as well, to not having the kind of mentorship, one-on-one mentorship in the lab that they're expected normally to have. And then obviously the coursework that's online maybe isn't always as good as it could be, and they're not seeing their classmates as well. So there's many different impacts. We think that it will probably result in some delays. We will expect that everyone takes these delays into account, and they don't get criticized or otherwise have reduced grades being held back. One of the things we have at UCI, and I'm sure you may have something similar there, is advancement, for instance, where it's kind of a middle step in the PhD. So normally one would have to do that after a certain time. So some of those might be delayed. So we just have to take all this into account. I will say that because of the really hard work of the health and safety people and other people at UCI, we have been able to like I said, have at least 30% occupancy and also have people coming in on a shift system to minimize the delays to grad student education. It's been very challenging, but we're all working really hard to make sure the impact is as minimal as possible.
Thank you very much. The question is mainly because we haven't had such a lockdown and our postgraduate students or specialty trainees haven't actually suffered that much in their clinical skills, but we do understand that other countries have, and if this pandemic goes actually increases in Korea, we might have to be in a very similar situation. So learning from another country which has actually dealt with it in a much more difficult way will be helpful for us in the future if this ever comes to fruition. Thank you.
I think a big one is just making sure you have plans to facilitate labs to keep going safely.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you can avoid the delays to a large part, but you just have to put safety plans in place. Hopefully you won't get there, but if you do, we're very willing to share everything that we've done to help keep things going.
Thank you.
There is some comment on chat window, the Michael and Khan, so they are very much interested in the product of Professor Go. So they suggest, why don't we have some medical education joint meeting to develop more virtual case. So Professor Michael and Khan, do you have any comment or a suggestion related to virtual case?
Yeah, this is really exciting. I think this is one of the reasons why these joint symposiums are so wonderful, to learn from you and to share ideas. We would love to have you come and talk specifically about this with our medical education mm-hmm. team. Mm-hmm. As you know, we're very interested in being high tech in mm-hmm. terms of education. So we have your email address and we'll be reaching out.
I'm guessing you're an interventional radiologist, correct?
Sorry, could you ask the question again?
Dr. Chu, you're an interventional radiologist?
Actually, I'm an anesthesiologist and pain medicine specialist, and I mostly perform the pain medicine procedures.
Excellent. So we might also have our pain team or our IR team also participate, Dr. Lane-Buckland, in case they have interest as well.
Great.
Has it been useful for training fellows and residents, or is this really aimed mostly for medical students?
I'm just preparing for the education, tutoring the residents or fellows mostly, but I'm also preparing for the some easier options to the medical students too.
Excellent, thank you.
Great.
Thank you very much.
I am very excited to develop new project with UCI and Korea University to develop virtual case and virtual any kind of things. So thank you so much for your attention and very active participation. It's now took a moment to closing. So now it's time to Professor Huang.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Lee. So let me tell you something briefly prior to closing remarks. I made some thank you note, but I worry, you know, rusty in translation to English in my brain, and I want to include some people, so all people who, you know, I show my appreciation to. So I wrote this note. I confess this first. When I, you know, take up this position, Associate Dean for Research Affairs, the prestigious in this position, Professor Sun, told me, we host and organize KU-UCI Symposium this year. So I had no idea how to, you know, organize this meeting. Furthermore, COVID-19 led me into chaos. Fortunately, UCI proposed the theme of a symposium. Let's share some, you know, knowledge about COVID-19. So online meeting between UCI and KU was enough to prepare this event. Even though 1 month preparing time was not enough, all speakers gladly agreed to join and share their experience and knowledge in research and clinic. So I prepared small souvenir for UCI speaker here. Necktie for men and scarf for women. But unfortunately, I cannot give you the, you know, the opportunity to select in the color. Sorry. And I also included a pen with the Korea University mark on it. Next week, we will send them. Yeah, please enjoy this, you know, the small gift. And Korean speaker will be given a wine set, maybe from, you know, Napa Valley in California. Yeah. So now I have to say thank you, UCI member Professor Ebert and Professor Bota and Ms. Emily Davidoff and Dr. Singh to organize this meeting in UCI. And I will send the gift to you and Dean Professor Thomas. So, yeah. Here, many members helped me to prepare this symposium. Associate Dean for External Affairs, Professor Yoon. Actually, he's online. Do you have any comment, Dr. Yoon?
Yeah. Yeah. Good morning, Seoul, and good morning, Olga. It was a very interesting and informative symposium. I appreciate all the speakers, our staff, and UCI partners. Especially thank Professor Bota and Professor Ebert and Professor Demos. I'm very, very looking forward to getting together at Irvine this time next year. Take care, everyone. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Actually, he's co-organizer of this meeting in KU. And Professor Soojin Kim, she was selected as KU-UCI ambassador this year. Soojin Kim. Say hello.
Hey, hello.
Yeah, however, she is still here because of Corona. Sorry for that. I hope she will touch with you there next year. Associate Dean for Academic Affairs, Professor Pyeon, former ambassador for UCI. Yeah, he is here there. Say hello.
Hi, all the UCI professors and Korean professors. Yeah, thank you for all the professors for the active participation. Thank you.
Yeah, he's, you know, Dr. Pyeon is always our leader. Of course, you know, Dean Professor Yoon is our best supporter. And other associated dean, including Dr. Hyunsoo Kim, and you know, and the my member in research affair, Dr. Yu, and here, you can see, yeah, Dr. E, yeah, they support a lot. Yeah, I appreciate their sincere support. Actually, you know, Miss Sunny Park arranged all for this symposium here. You know, many times I push her. Yeah, sorry for that. Say hello. Okay, there. Oh, sorry. What is this? So, you know, this program is managed by CDM the Big. Yeah, thank you for your service. Please show, you know, please turn the camera to them. Yeah, we manage this, you know, this is in a symposium with this, you know, system. And yeah, from now on, I hope to improve this relationship between UCI and KU more strongly. Lastly, thank everybody here, and I hope you will take good energy from this meeting to fight COVID-19. Yeah, thank you, and bless, God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll just say a couple of words. I know the time is running late. I wanted to also really appreciate the meeting. And I know I wasn't able to attend most of the meeting because of other obligations, but I was able to attend the beginning and the end. And I've gotten incredible feedback from our team on the value of the meeting. I want to especially appreciate Julie Hume and our vice deans, Leigh Buckland, Boda, and Abbott, for their considerable efforts to pull off a really successful meeting, and all of the lecturers on both sides. You know, this year we had to have the meeting on neutral territory, right? We weren't able to visit Seoul, and you weren't able to visit Irvine, so it was a neutral site. So we hope to get back for the fourth meeting to Seoul, I hope. The bibimbap in California is not bad, but it's not the same as it is in Seoul. And so we look forward to another visit, although we'd also be delighted to host you as well. And I hope that lots of further interactions arise from this. I also want to thank our global engagement team, Victoria Jones and Haiwan Shin, for really pushing us forward on this and really helping to engage with our friends across the Pacific Ocean. So thank you all. And it's great to see all of our old friends, including Professor Hong Sik Lee. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Everybody, please stay safe and healthy.
Yeah, could you give us some mention, Dr. Bokta and Dr. Ebert?
I know that the time is getting ready for California to close and spend some time with our loved ones. And I know that you are getting ready to go with your working day. We are very grateful for everybody that has joined us during those 4 days that we have spent together. It was very rewarding to me to see that between 70 and 100 people found the time to enjoy our common joint experience. I think that I do not have any favorite days out of those four. There are so many different aspects of the COVID-19 pandemic that we are all trying to figure together, from epidemiology to clinical work to translational research, to basic research that's going to give us the solutions to apply through translation into our clinics. And the last but not the least, we know that this is probably not the last medical event in our medical careers, and training and protecting our next generation is equally important for us. We have learned a lot from each other. I know that Dr. Abbott and myself will make one of our very important priorities to try to convince Dean Stamos to support and fund some common projects. This is my very nice way to ask for money. I do it all the time. That's part of my job as being involved in research. Research needs funds, education needs funds, and we are very grateful to both of our deans for giving all the support for this event as well as to many, many other events.
Thank you.
I'd just like to add, thank you so much to Professors Wang, Yoon, Kim, and Lee, and all our colleagues in clinical sphere research and education at Korea University. Thank you for hosting such a wonderful and stimulating conference. I'd like to thank all the speakers who took the time to prepare in this most busy and crazy of times. Thank you so much to Sunhee Park from Korea University and Emily Dawidoff from UCI for all the coordination and organization that you've done over the last few weeks. And thank you very much to Global Engagement for connecting UCI and Korea University. I'd also like to especially thank Assistant Dean Julie Yum, who gave a great talk today and who has been so helpful in coordinating and helping all the speakers at UCI record their talks. Finally, just like to say, this has been an incredible, unique opportunity to compare the clinical research and educational responses of two medical schools located in very different countries who are friends, but very different, with very different pandemic responses. The willingness of everyone involved to participate and share their unique insights has been heartening and demonstrates what is possible when institutions and countries cooperate, collaborate, and participate in candid and free exchange of ideas. So thank you everyone for making this conference a great success.
Thank you, Albert and Bota. So now we have around 73 attendees here, even though today is Saturday in Seoul. So thank you for that, you know. And it's, you know, almost in the time's up. Do you have any, you know, comment or question? Question left? Nothing? Okay. Let's close this meeting. Thank you for, and I hope we will see you, you know, soon. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Yeah.